Welcome to We're on the Pier, and guess who's here with me, Yael Breuer. Now the Pier has had some great music concerts over the years. Listen to this one and see if you can recognize who that is.
Joanna, I can't forget the one they call Joanna. We owned the summer hand in hand, Joanna. And on his heart is still a trace of you. Goodbye. For lovers that may find you, I still hang on to every word that day you passed my way, Joanna. You made the man a child again, so sweetly breathed in your smile, lived in your eyes completely. And on this heart, there's still a trace of you. I love you, but nothing in this world could make you mine. Yet still in time, Joanna. Joanna, you may remember me and change your
That was Joanna by Scott Walker, only sung by Glenn here. Glenn, that was so good. In fact, you started looking like Scott Walker while singing. It was so amazing.
Morphing.
I'm laughing now, but I was in tears.
Wow. That's what we want. We want an audience emoting.
You will.
Massively.
You will. So you're going to do a Scott Walker tribute evening, right?
Yeah.
At the Rialto in July.
That's right.
Tell me a little bit about it. What do we expect when coming there?
Well, what you can expect is going to be me on stage. Hopefully I'll be on stage most of the time with the piano, and I'm going to be welcoming up guests, some of which will be from the Brighton Beach Boys.
So you're a member of the Brighton Beach Boys as well.
That's right. And over the years, the Brighton Beach Boys have changed into doing... We kind of got bored playing Beach Boys music, so we do all sorts of different things now until we kind of forgot what we started doing it for in the first place.
So some of the members will be at the evening, but this is very much you and guests doing Scott Walker, yeah?
That's right, yeah. So some of them will be from the Brighton Beach Boys and also Jake Shillingford from My Life Story, who's a massive Scott Walker fan. Apparently he's just made an album. A friend of mine from the Brighton Beach Boys was telling me he's just made an album which is just peppered with Scott Walker references. He just thought, I'm going to expunge it. I'm going to get it all out, you know, there.
Right.
So that's going to be one for...
I mean, Scott Walker, sadly, very sadly, died recently. I was so shocked, partly because this is a little bit weird, actually. Maybe I shouldn't come out and tell you about this, but I've always hoped to meet him one day. I always had this thing about Scott Walker, but not... I'm not the only one, I know that, but I always thought that I might meet him one day. He was such an incredible person and very, very private, I know. Mm. And the older stuff, the older songs like Joanna are definitely my favourite. I think over the years, he kind of rejected that kind of music and did his own, which was not as listenable as the old stuff. Do you touch upon that as well? Or
We do. In fact, Gus, who's going to be joining us later on, he's going to be singing a song from one of Scott's... Well, when he really started his amazing voyage into the avant-garde.
Right.
A song called Farmer in the City. And it's probably the only thing off of that album that you could probably do with a piano and a man singing. Otherwise, you kind of need bits off of a ship and, you know, space hoppers that you can punch and things like that. You know, it gets quite beyond our realms. We just need a huge stage to
yes.
do it.
But yeah. Only I think that was really him. That was what he liked. But of course, yeah. the you know, the old romantic songs, plus the songs of Jacques Brel that he sang, they're just so powerful and amazing. And, incredible, you know, yeah. even though sung in English, you know, the French translated from French, they were just yeah. incredible.
Yeah, I love it. Love it all, actually.
Yes, never great. So I'm really looking for that forward to that gig. So take me through the details again.
Okay, so we're going to be on stage at 8 o'clock. It's the 14th of July, and it's at the Rialto Theatre, just in the centre of town as you go up Dyke Road.
Great, okay. Yeah. I'll bring my tissues.
Yes, please.
Thank you, Glen.
No problem, thank you.
Hello, Karen.
Hello.
Tell me, why are you on the pier today?
We have got a one-day trip from London. We are here with five classes from Germany, and we stay at London, and today we want to have a trip to Brighton. We want to see the pier, we want to see the sea, and in 2 hours we will go to the town inside right. and have a look there.
How old are the children?
They are between 15 and 17.
Right, and what do they think about the pier already?
Well, we have just started entering the pier. I see that there are a lot of games inside, so they are challenging for the young people. And we have just started walking around, so I can't say a lot about it. We have just been sitting and lying at the beach.
Yes, you have a beautiful day for it.
I hope the weather will stay fine.
Yeah, well, you never know, but at the moment it's lovely. Do you have anything like this in Germany? Any pier like this?
No, we haven't got. Well, but there is the Lake of Constance, but without a pier, but with nice beaches and nice towns, villages around it, yes.
Right. And are the children going to learn about Brighton as well, or is it pure fun today?
It's pure fun today. They are not going to learn anything about it.
Right, okay, well, Brighton is for fun.
We hope they will improve their English. They will do an exam next year, and so it's a kind of trip for improving their language.
Lovely. Well, have fun today. Thank
have
you very
nice
much.
Have a nice day too.
Thanks. Thank you. Right, I have Sue and David all the way from London, yes? Tell me, why did you come to Brighton Pier today, Sue?
With the over 55s, Chalk Triangle, and we live.
So you've got an organised tour yeah. for the day. And David, you said you haven't been for a few years, but you used to come here nearly every week.
I used to come here near enough every week, you know, rain, sunshine, whatever the weather, and, you know, so I come once a month now and, you know, see how we're doing. You know, you've got the great weather. We're a bit cloudy today, but yeah, it's fine.
And you clearly like Brighton Pier.
I love it.
Why is that? What do you like about it?
Oh, I just love the people on it, you know, and it's just nice. And it's a lovely little beach.
Great. And Sue, you just bought some donuts, did you?
Yeah, I've got them donuts. Right. My favourite.
And have you been on Brighton Pier before?
Yeah.
And you like it?
Yeah, it's quite nice down here.
Yeah. Great. Well, enjoy the rest of the day.
I will.
Thank you. From Accessories Souvenirs, he's here with me. Hello, Adnan.
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm fine. That's a lovely, fun shop you have here.
Oh, yeah, it's lovely.
Tell me a little bit about it. What do you sell and who do you sell it to?
We sell lots of gifts items to basically to the children's. Like we have the very trendy products here.
Right.
So we receive lots of tourists and the lots of children around the town and the local people here.
Right.
They all come to love to see us here.
Yeah. Lots of football teams that are represented. Any favorite ones?
Well, all of my favorite because all sell good.
Right.
Yeah, we have very official stuff from all the football teams. Like you can see, like from international teams as well.
Yeah.
Like Barcelona, Liverpool, like the champions. We have all of the different stuffs.
Right, and you're right at the beginning of the pier. So as soon as people come in, they see your booth. Have you met any interesting people while being here?
Yeah, quite a lot. It's been interesting. Like a few weeks ago, there was a film was shooting here. It was a Bollywood movie, and the quite famous stars was here. They're just right here. They were dancing in here.
Oh,
so it's
nice.
Quite lovely to see. And yeah, it's every single day is a new experience.
Great.
Quite nice people. It's nice environment here, I should say.
It's a lovely place. And
yeah.
the weather is like this, it's particularly nice.
Oh, it's so beautiful in here. You see, everybody is here is charming and smiling. It's not like any high street place where people are in stress or rushing. It's a bit calm, and I should recommend to people to come over here.
Definitely. And well, a lot of people do, don't they? Yeah, very busy.
Very busy, and all the way back, they have nice deck chairs so you can relax yourself with a cup of tea or ice cream on hand.
Great. Adnan, thank you so much.
You're most welcome.
And that's it for the first half. Join us after the break. Welcome back to We're on the Pier, and guess who's here? Let's find out. Walking football in Brighton, and I have Jobe Berrington to tell me a little bit about it. Hi, Jobe.
Hi, yeah.
I have to admit, I never heard of walking football until recently, and when I did, I thought, walking and football, what is it all about?
Well, you probably haven't heard about it because it is relatively new. I've been playing for 4 years. And I formed the Brighton and Hove Walking Football Club 4 years ago, and we've become more and more popular. We've got about 50 members.
Right.
The attraction is that it is football, but it's, as the title says, walking, which means it is much more gentle. So for people my age and other people, and ladies as well,
right.
it's an ideal way of playing the game because it's taken away the physical side of it that you get, even in vets football. Which
but presumably it's still a sport, obviously, and it's
you still use a lot of energy. Yes, it surprises people because they think walking, oh, well, you're just going to be strolling around. But in fact, you really do work up, quite
I mean, there's power walking, which is a very difficult
There is.
Very energetic.
And in theory, you could do that because the rule is you have to have one foot on the floor. If you've got one foot on the floor, you're walking. If you've got both feet off the floor,
then you're no longer walking.
You can't run without taking both feet off the floor.
Okay. So the Brighton Club is open to anybody, over the age of 50?
We have three sessions, and two of them are at Freedom Leisure Centres, so people can just walk in. Sunday sessions in the park, people can just turn up. If they're going to stay, have to become a member because that's our own session and we use our own kit.
Okay.
But yeah, anybody can come, look, just watch for the first time or just come and play for a little.
So to recap, let's go through the benefits. Obviously, there's the physical activity.
There's the physical activity, but there's also the mental activity because you're feeling good. It's really good for helping with things like depressions, etc. It's great because you've got all the banter, that's sort of like always, like in any football, you're always talking to one another. We've got the social side of it.
Yeah, because you are a club, so presumably people socialise.
We have social events, yeah.
Excellent. I'm intrigued because maybe it's some people would be novices, but some people will have come to the club because they like football. Maybe they played football when they were younger and now because they're not as mobile as they used to be, they're doing walking football. But isn't there the temptation to just kind of start running and kicking the ball is it quite strict?
It's the one thing that people sort of like say. They look at a game and say, but he's running.
Right.
Because we are moving fast. And our biggest problem is to stop running. Because the ball's there, you go, oh no. And the whistle goes and you're blown up.
Okay.
Because it's very hard to cut out that instinct.
Yes, I can imagine. Yeah, and so Brighton has a thriving walking football community, but also Brighton was the home for the very first international walking football
game.
Is that
last
right?
Last year they had Italy versus England.
Who won?
And we did, of course.
Hey.
Being England.
Right.
Both the over 65s and the over 55s.
So both won the
two different internationals.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, great. So, final question, how do people find out about you?
We have a website, brightonwfc.com.
Mm-hmm.
All the information is on there, and there's email contacts that they can get through to me, and I can give them information about the various
That's great, about the localities.
And what you said earlier on about people playing, being playing all alive, we get quite a lot of people coming along who have not played before.
Right.
I'm one.
Okay, really?
I never played football.
I assumed you were a footballer.
No.
Okay.
I went to a rugby playing grammar school.
Right.
And played at art college, would you believe?
Right.
That's my experience.
Okay, well, that's a good example. So anyone can come and anyone is welcome.
Ladies, and although it's technically for over 50s, we do have people who join us younger and particularly people with disabilities, etc.
Okay, that's good to know. Thank you so much for coming to the studio.
Thank you.
I have Simon Shepherd in the studio with me. Simon Shepherd is an artist and he is based in Brighton. Welcome, Simon.
Thank you.
You know, I've been trying to think how to introduce you, what type of artist, and I found that difficult because I know your art, I've seen your art, you're very prolific, but also you cross various genres. It's a little bit of pop art, a little bit of street art, a little bit, you know, sculpture, all sorts of things. Maybe you do the hard work for me and define your art.
Well, you're right. It does cross boundaries and genres. I would say that almost all of it is 3D sculptural work. So that is one thing that you could say about my work. But I don't like to be defined too much in terms of genre. And I like to use different materials and always look to make newer things with new ideas and sometimes new material.
Right. And talking about materials, I attended one of your exhibitions a couple of years ago in Brighton. And I had to go very close and do a double take with some of the works of art because they were so realistic. I just nearly didn't believe you that, you know, that some of them were made of clay. There was, and we'll show some of these on the screen, there was this basketball within a conker. I couldn't believe that it wasn't a real basketball, but it wasn't. And other things. And they all have kind of, whether intentional or not, some messages. Shall we talk about that basketball, for example? First of all, the name of the piece of work.
So the piece is called Divide and Conquer.
Right. Conquer spelt as in
C-O-N-K-E-R. Yes, exactly. And I do like to use humour sometimes in the title or even in the work. It came about because I was thinking about, first of all, I loved that classic design of the basketball. I'm not a basketball player or fan, but it was something about the shape and the design with the different textures and colours that appealed to me. So I wanted to make some work around that design and that object.
Right.
And through almost play, if you like, it came together. I wanted to use something that was man-made, like the basketball, but to combine it with something from the natural world that complemented it or juxtaposed with it. And the thing I used in the end was a conker shell because it made the basketball look like the
inside of the conker. And I mean, do you, you know how it is, sometimes you look at a work of art and you interpret it, and whether the artist actually meant it or not, a bit like in poetry, is more or less irrelevant if you see something in it. But do you mean to convey, within that slight humor context, some deeper messages? I mean, there is the Coca-Cola cans that are shaped as a cross. What did you mean there, for example?
That piece is probably a more obvious one in terms of meaning, because I'd been thinking about the way in which many people today almost worship the idea of brand, material goods, if you like. And the epitome of that for me was Coca-Cola, the way they brand and market themselves. So it seemed to me that they were almost worshipping, or
right,
people do worship brands, and I used the Coca-Cola can in the form of a cross to combine those ideas.
So you gave it a religious context, which is slightly controversial.
That's okay. I don't mind that.
Right. Right. And then, of course, there are the hands, little children's hands, which is a little bit of a disturbing piece of art, I thought, all kind of confined into a box.
It surprises me when people are disturbed by my art.
Really?
But again, I don't perhaps necessarily mind that much.
Right.
I wanted to take a shape that was quite, a shape that was familiar, but quite, the shape of a hand is quite hard to describe. It's not square or round or whatever. But by putting enough of them together in a confined space, then that brought another level of aestheticism to the work.
Right.
It was something quite natural, quite artificial shape, if
right,
you like. So it was playing with that idea.
Okay. So really, if I did try to find some kind of theme, as I said, you have such a variety of works. You take familiar objects and you kind of deconstruct them. You put them in a slightly unfamiliar, odd context.
Yes, you're right.
That's
an underlying theme in the work.
Okay.
Yeah.
And talking about that, you've got something to show?
I did bring something along today.
Go on.
Okay. So, a new piece of work.
Maybe if you try to show it to the camera.
Okay, I don't know if the camera picks it up, but
that's the map of
it's the British Isles,
mm-hmm,
but it's made up of this wood chip wallpaper. And I was thinking about the idea of randomly tearing away paper from a wall, if you like, stripping wallpaper away, and being left with shapes which we then see
meaning in or try to find meaning in.
Right.
And a very sort of random shape, which is also very familiar to us, I thought was the British Isles.
So it's like an old wall.
This represents
with
an old wall
being
with
apart.
Paper being old wallpaper being ripped off, and something being left behind.
Right.
In this case, the.
So I'm sure there could be layers and layers of interpretations, especially with Brexit, etc., etc. We won't go into it. So Simon, I know you're involved with various projects and various exhibitions. How can people look you up and find out what you do, what you're up to?
I find that Instagram is an immediate way for me to upload work that I'm working on currently, uh-huh. show people what I'm doing. So if you are on Instagram and you look on Instagram, it's Simon Shepherd Art, and you'll see my work there. And I try to post, not too much, but new work and significant work when it comes along.
Lovely. Simon, thank you so much for coming.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And that's the end of today's We're on the Pier programme. We've had the most amazing weather. Don't forget to join us again every evening at 8:30. The bottom.